All right, everybody, I would like to welcome to this sustainability seminar series being run by Kiran C. Patel Center of Sustainable Development at IIT Gandhinagar. And the center aims to conduct high quality research that makes an impact, also outreach and other programs related to training and capacity building, primarily in the areas of climate change, public health, agriculture, water, and energy. So the basically, we used to have this seminar series by inviting our speakers at campus, and they would normally stay a day, interact with different faculty members, students, deliver a talk, which during this lockdown, we were not able to do. And then we waited for a while thinking that things would become normal. And then after all, we decided that we should probably keep it going in online mode. And so this seminar series was started about a month back. And we have had quite a good number of, talks, which were well attended by the participants, not only from India, but also from other countries. So having said that, let me get the privilege to introduce Professor Sachidanand Tripathi, who is our distinguished speaker for today's seminar series. So Dr. Professor Tripathi is a higher administrative grade professor and currently head of the Department of Civil Engineering at Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur. He is the recipient of prestigious Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, which is the highest recognition in science and technology awarded by the Government of India. He has been also recognized as Distinguished Alumnus Award of Banaras Hindu University. And he has been elected as a fellow of the Indian National Science Academy, Indian National Academy of Engineering, and Indian National Academy of National Academy of Sciences of India. Goddard Space Flight Center, and Professor Tripathi has made tremendous contribution when we think about the topic air pollution or challenges associated with air pollution. And along those lines, he has built groundbreaking innovative approaches to quantify the accuracy, affordability, and feasibility of indigenously built low-cost sensor-based network technologies for nationwide urban air quality monitoring and real-time source appointment. He is also the lead national coordinator of the National Knowledge Network, formed under the National Clean Air Mission, and an expert member of the steering committee, NCAP, MOEFCC, which is Ministry of Environment and Forest Climate Change, and member of Executive Council Climate Change Program, Department of Science and Technology. He is the principal investigator of National Aerosol Facility, which is first of its kind in Asia or in Asian universities, which was created with the support of Department of Atomic Energy. So it's a pleasure to have Professor Tripathi for today's talk. And I can tell you that air quality is something, you know, everybody is interested about nowadays, because so few parts of our country gets really bad air quality during the winter because of different reasons. So we will know more about what are the reasons of poor air quality and what are the challenges and how we can fix that probably in today's talk from Professor Sachidanand Tripathi. So please join me to welcome Professor Tripathi for this talk under the sustainability seminar series of Kiran C. Patel Center of Sustainable Development. Thank you very much. So Professor Tripathi, now, whenever you feel comfortable, you may start, please.
Thank you, Professor Mishra, and thank you, Kiran Shri Patel, Center for Sustainable Development at IIT Gandhinagar. I really feel privileged to be part of this seminar series. I hope I'm audible and my slides are visible to everyone.
Yep.
So what I'm going to talk about is some flavor of air pollution, but since this center is about sustainable development, and I believe people have some interest also in getting to know about how air pollution can be a part of, or how air pollution management can be made as a part of sustainable development, which we are hoping to see in this country. And of course, there are sustainable development goals set by United Nations. So the talk will be oriented in that line. And as we go along, we'll also talk about a couple of important national programs which has been launched in last couple of years, which are aiming to basically try to solve the air pollution related problems and what benefits one can accrue from these things. So these are some of the things I will talk about. So this work has been very generously supported by several of government departments, including Department of Science Technology, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Earth Sciences, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Central Pollution Control Board, as well as India-US Science and Technology Forum and Bloomberg Philanthropies, and of course, many PhD students, postdoctoral fellows, project staff, and many collaborators have contributed to some of the work, which I'm going to show as we go along. So the way I have designed this talk is that with a very brief introduction, I'd like to say few things about the sustainability, what kind of framework one can have when one tries to achieve sustainability. And then as Bimal talked about that, some focus I will give on aerosols and what linkages it has with climate change. And again, as we talk about climate change, we are more looking from the point of view in how we can improve climate change predictions by incorporating aerosol effects, because that is one thing which brings a lot of uncertainty into predicting the climate change, as you know that, as IPCC has very clearly pointed out. And then I will show some of our results and results from other people's that how aerosols can cause some changes in the plant physiology, and through other processes, it can impact crop yield. So those things I will discuss. And I will also discuss that what are the health impacts aerosols in particular and air pollution can cause, and what kind of then benefits we can derive if we try to mitigate the pollution in terms of, you know, avoiding the loss to life or loss to crop or agriculture, loss to our monumental heritages, etc. And then some idea I will give you that some new techniques, new technologies we are trying to understand sources of pollution and maybe amount of pollution in Ganga Plains. And then what are the mitigation benefits we have if we try to monetize them? And then several national programs which are going on and how we are contributing, and we are trying to bring all higher institutions of higher learning, technical institutions to basically strengthen these programs as they unfold in the country. So this is a new concept which was basically proposed by Professor Anu Ramaswamy, who is currently at Princeton University. At one time, she was our collaborator. This paper came out in Science, and what she calls it as social ecological infrastructure systems. So she has actually proposed a framework where you can try to understand these things within a system, and within a system there are subsystems. So what you see here in this cartoon on the left, you have this urban ecology where individuals live, they practice their things, and they do their daily chores. And because of that, some emissions happens, and they also consume in form of food and energy. And what you see after that, you have these large, you know, sets of buildings, basically urban infrastructure, if you like. And then dotted lines, what people started call it urban metabolism. So basically the idea what you see, a dotted line is created by which you can understand what is the influx and outflux of material and energy from this dotted line which you call as a city. And that's the key thing, that as the material and energy moves in and out, you like to see its footprint. And that's the key thing, its footprint in terms of greenhouse gases, which becomes climate change, or in terms of other risks involved. I will talk about those in subsequent slide. As you move a little out, you see that you have industrial belts or what we call industrial parks, etc., where you have these large industrial clusters sitting around. And from there, basically, the production of energy, production of food, etc., happens. And that gets consumed within this urban conglomerate. And as we move a little more out, what you have here are the basically natural systems. You have large farms, large mining sector, which you extract in order to get mineral, you order to get the raw material for food, etc. And in the bottom, what you see, there are some arrows, which shows that what are the scales and what are the actors involved. So you see at a smallest scale, at the household scales, you have individual users. And then as you keep on going on bigger scales, you have policy actors, for example, the people who design these infrastructures, the people who operate them, and they are all basically dictated or determined by high-level actors, for example, city governance, state governance, or maybe the country-level government, okay? And those things, what happens as you go from home scale, you go to urban or regional scale in between, and finally you move to the global scale. And that point, what has been now shown here on the right side, that, in the upper side, basically you have different risks. So at the home, when you cook, depending on what you cook, how you cook, you are exposed to indoor air pollution. And then slowly as you move through this urban centers, there are a variety of sources because of energy or the transport or other things, different kind of pollution may come out, and that can pose different type of risks. And finally, all them put together, actually it becomes larger and larger plume, as you know, as it enters into the global, at the global scale. That becomes what we call as the global climate change. And the institutions, what you look here again, starting from home, and finally you go at the, at the global scale, there are different kind of people who are going to deal with this problem or will try to solve these issues. So that is what you can say, a conceptual, very nice framework, what was proposed in the paper, which came out in Science a couple of years ago. And then you see that it's very important to understand that such kind of very, very complex problems cannot be solved by the people who are learning or practicing in a single discipline. Rather, it requires a truly a very interdisciplinary approach. So what you see that in the blue boxes, you have that the things which are coming from social or behavioral or policy sciences, and these are what they call it as social actors. And what they teach, what they practice, or the lessons you get in the classes comes out as a change in your behavior, behavioral changes. And that is going to reflect the way you design your infrastructure. So now you try to practice those things and you will definitely make your infrastructure which are more sustainable, right? Which will have lesser footprint in terms of carbon dioxide, right? That's the key thing. But that's not only limited to that. That's of course is a very important indicator, but as we know that we come to the urban or local scales or neighborhood scales, we also like to reduce the footprints in terms of particulate matter emissions and many other things. So these things of course now will be governed by more engineering considerations, for example, infrastructure engineering, architecture engineering, or urban planning, etc. And then finally, you come to the basically the matrices which you use to say how sustainable a city is. And then you try to look into these matrices, for example, pollution footprint, resource footprint, et cetera, and those are defined or basically you learn in the disciplines like industrial ecology, environmental science and engineering, climatology, public health, et cetera. So what you see here is that there's a whole umbrella of disciplines, each of them are their in own right are full, you can say, full-fledged practice disciplines. But when it comes to practicing sustainability or achieving sustainable goals, we need to have all these minds come together and try to solve these problems. So in that paper, they also tried to basically look into that couple of these major sectors, what kind of footprints they have in terms of global anthropogenic greenhouse gas emission, that's on the left plot what you see, and what kind of global water withdrawal they have. And what you see that very interestingly, that whereas the all the energy supply related sectors, they have the largest footprint in terms of carbon dioxide, but when it comes to the water withdrawal, agriculture and livestock related sectors have largest, you know, withdrawal things. So what that's what we call here many times, you hear this, the food, water and energy nexus. So that kind of nexus you clearly see here. And on the right hand side, what you have here is that some of these different major set of activities, what are the risks associated with them? And mostly what this talk is going to focus about, as Bimal mentioned earlier, is about air pollution, indoor and outdoor. And you see that, of course, there are a large number of mortalities associated with these different type of risks. But air pollution itself by now actually is causing about 6 million, globally 6 million mortality per year. And this estimate is, I think, a couple of years old. So currently in India itself, they are saying it's somewhere between 1.5 to 2 million mortality that's happening because of air pollution per year. So since we are talking about air pollution, very briefly, some of you who are probably know it or not so well introduced with the aerosol, I will just give you some idea, because remember that when we talk about air pollution, there are a variety of them. There are gases, there are particulate matter, which we call as aerosol sometimes, loosely speaking. But when it comes to the health-related effects, 90% of the health effects can be avoided if we are able to solve the problem of aerosols, right? Unwanted aerosols, let's put it, that becomes pollution. So that's what I'm just going to give you, that one slide complete idea about what aerosols are all about. We already discussed here that you have, as you move from these, you know, urban areas, there are houses, and then as you move from urban to peri-urban to rural, and then finally to biogenic sources where trees, forests, plants, etc. are there. And they all emit a variety of things. You have these VOCs, ammonia, SOx, or black carbon, which we call soot particles, and then different kind of gases. I'm not going to list them all. And then very prominent, some of these volatile organic compounds, very, very important for in terms of forming the secondary organic aerosols. And you see that there are different processes happening, and through that they form these secondary organic aerosols. These have become quite prominent because they constitute from 20 to 40% of urban particulate matter mass currently in India. So that's why it's quite important to understand them and their precursors, which are coming from plant and from other sources. And what you see that subsequently they undergo a variety of process, very, very complex chemical and physical processes. And finally, either they form fog and get removed through sedimentation, or they enter into cloud droplet. And then again, by, you know, rainfall, they can be removed from atmosphere. And by doing so, by forming cloud, they can also interact with radiation. So that's what we call as a indirect forcing on climate, which has become one of the huge, largest uncertainty currently, which is impeding our ability to correctly predict climate. And not only that, they can also directly interact with radiation, and that's what we call as direct forcing of aerosol particles. And on the left, what you see that all these processes are basically grouped into three broad categories. So what you see on the very bottom, all this is called as emission. Very important, because this is what determines how well your model can predict. You go a little up, these are different kind of chemical, physical transformation and growth. And then above that, how finally they grow, become cloud and interact with radiation. So that is how they physically exert on the global climate system finally. So this is a, just to give an idea, this is a cross section you see, this is India. And what you see, a part of India above peninsula is shown on the left hand side. And the color scale shows basically extinction coefficient of particulate matter. This data has been taken from satellite. And what you see that close to foothills of Himalayas, you have very high values of extinction coefficients. That has been shown by many authors. And on the right, what we see, the same thing, but as a function of altitude measured at Kanpur from a micropulse LIDAR, which has been here for 10 years now, it has been removed as a part of NASA network from 2008 to 2019, it was here. And this is the work done by my former PhD student, Chandan Sarangi, who is now a faculty member at IIT Madras. So what is shown here is basically that for same year 2009, and this is for morning, noon, and evening, what you see, there is a hump coming around 3 to 4 kilometers, which we call, and others also call it, either an elevated dust layer or an elevated aerosol layer. So it's a very high value, and that reason for that is still is under debate, that this is because of transport or local convection or both together. That's of course is a different matter. But what I'm showing that what effect it has. So currently Chandan just got a good paper out of that, looking into that EL, that enhanced layer, and how that is basically impacting the snow over high Himalayan region, mostly high Himalayan Asian region, you can call that. Basically what he called them, Western Himalaya, Hindu Kush, and Karakoram. So on the left side, what you see on the x-axis, you have number of these layers, and y-axis, you have altitude. And what you see, the largest number of these EELs, you find at about 4 to 3.5 to 4.5 kilometers. And on the x-axis from satellite, what is shown is the delta alpha in percentage term, and that is the albedo darkening. So you know that you have, if it's a fresh snow, it's about 0.99, very white. As it ages, it becomes, its albedo or reflectance decreases. Or if it has some impurity embedded into that, either because of dust deposition or soot deposition, its albedo decreases. And that's what he found in this paper, that at the height where EELs are mostly sitting, you have largest decrease in the albedo of this snow for particularly these three important regions, which constitutes Himalayan mountainous Asian region. And that then he tried to look further separately into these three regions. So what you see that there are three regressions he has done. On the x-axis is the log of the EL values in terms of when you try to, you know, integrate it over column. And on the y-axis are again the same value, which is delta alpha, which is the albedo or the snow albedo darkening. And you see that is a very good fit based on the multi-year data, which all goes with R square more than 0.8 and 0.9. And what he also, I think, concludes in this paper that these are mostly true for Western Himalayas. This is not true for Ganga Plains, Ganga River Basin. So that is what is an interesting thing and maybe has to be looked further into that. So why I'm showing that? Because there are at least one very good paper that came out in 2016 or 2015 that shows that, you know, that the darkening of snow would cause snow melt earlier than it used to. And therefore, it changes the discharge curve in the river. And that has been shown, it's a science paper, and that has been shown for the Colorado River, that such kind of thing. Of course, that was not because of this dust or black carbon deposition, that was more so because of the climate change effect, that is the greenhouse gas effect. But I believe these kind of things may also happen for the rivers which are feeding most of our plains. So if that kind of thing happens and you have early, you know, this melting of snow, certainly the discharge, et cetera, may change. And the people who plan for future, for the water requirement and projections of water, etc., has to be aware of this. This is another thing what we looked into some time back, again, mostly done with my student Chandan himself. And that we tried to look at how aerosols, cloud, and rainfall association is happening over Indian summer monsoon region. We call it as ICMR. So what you see here is on the top left, this is a map which is proposed by ICCP, International Cloud Climatology Project. So this, they have given this classic map where what you see on the x-axis, you have cloud optical thickness. So this is a thickness basically measured in terms of optics. And on the y-axis, you have cloud pressure. So what you see that, just to give an example, the deep cloud, what you see during summertime in India, very deep and thundery clouds like convection deep, they are, you see, they go very high up to 14, 15 kilometer. That's why they touch very low pressure and they are very deep. So they have very high cloud optical thickness. So we took huge amount of data from MODIS and we tried to map on this, that ICCP map, what you just show here. And what you see that actually it's very nicely CB clouds are fitting and they are constituting a good part of the overall clouds which form over Indian summer monsoon region, that is starting from part of June right through September. Okay, and what's the Indian summer monsoon region in terms of geography, I will show you in one or two slides later. And then overlaying on that is the rainfall. The rainfall data is taken from that 0.25 by 0.25 product, the latest product of IMD. And what you see that actually this cloud is also associated with the greatest amount of rainfall which happens in this region. So this is kind of, you can say, a very interesting actual laboratory, field laboratory to test some hypothesis where you probably propose that aerosol might be changing cloud microphysical processes and therefore might be exerting something on rainfall distribution, etc., etc. And that's what we are doing here. So this is what is that, this box is actually the what you call the standard Indian summer monsoon region. So meteorologists generally study this for understanding Indian summer monsoon. And over that is what is the optical depth. Some of you know that optical depth is the parameter which tells you the overall columnar amount of aerosol particles. And it's a non-dimensional value, but high the value, you know, you go for more red, it's high. And the second plot shows the cloud fraction. So that shows that most of the clouds are here. It's important that when the aerosols are here, whether the clouds are there as well or not. And very similar to the previous plots, what I showed earlier, it also has lots of rainfall, okay? So it's a very good, you know, laboratory to see that whether aerosols have any effect which is measurable and the signals are much larger than noise. Let's put it this way. And what is shown here in these five panels on the bottom is each one of them on the x-axis is aerosol optical depth. So going from 0 to 1, 1 means very, very polluted atmosphere. And somewhere 0.4 to 0.5 is also very polluted compared to clean regions in the world. And on the y-axis, you have rainfall, then you have precipitation rate, you have cloud fraction, cloud top pressure, and then cloud top temperature, right? And what you see here is that as the optical depth aerosol increases, and this is done on large number of data, you see around, you have data ranging from 500 to 700-800. And these are binned. So each number, each dot is equal to certain amount and these are equally distributed, right? So what you see that increasing aerosol causes increase in rainfall in this region. It also causes an increase in precipitation rate. So that's well known that if precipitation rate changes, it is because of some changes in microphysical processes in the cloud. Not only that, you see cloud fraction changes. That means more clouds are forming. Cloud top pressure is decreasing. You see that is going from about 650 millibar to 380 millibar. So it means that cloud is growing higher and higher, and that is further supported by cloud top temperature. So you see that as cloud grow and goes higher up, then its temperature will become colder. So there's a very clear kind of indication that aerosols are bringing some important microphysical changes in the clouds, which are causing clouds to grow, not only spatially, but also vertically. Okay. This, we also look further in a follow-up work, again, done by Chandan, while he was here only. And there we again looked, and our idea was that if so much of changes are happening in the cloud, what kind of warming or cooling they might be causing at the surface. Okay. So first we just looked into the summary things, what I just showed before. So I will not individually explain all these plots here, but the idea of these plots again are that the same region, what I showed earlier was the ISMR region, has more pollution, more clouds are forming. And they also have one other things we have plotted here. If this plot you show in the bottom panel in the middle, it shows that they are also more reflecting. This scale is for cloud albedo, how well clouds are reflecting as it goes from a smaller value to larger. That means clouds are more reflecting, more whitening. And it shows that, yes, all those things are happening in that region. And if that is true, then can we look into the radiation budget, that what changes in the energy balance these clouds or this aerosol induced changes in the macro and micro physical processes of clouds are causing over the energy balance at the top of atmosphere and at the surface. And remember that some of these energy balance not only determine the meteorological circulation and monsoon development in this year, but it also has a memory effect, and that can cause changes in the monsoon development in the subsequent years, right? So this is what we have again done here, where on the x-axis, you see you have this are the albedo I just showed. On the y-axis, you have cloud fraction. This is cloud top pressure. This again cloud fraction on the y-axis. And these dots are, again, a bin analysis has been done here. And these dots are color-coded. So you see the color coding is from blue to red, you go from less polluted to very high polluted. All the top panels are based on the MODIS data, satellite data, and exactly same analysis has been done in the similar fashion using MERA data. MERA, you know, which is a very standard, very well used reanalysis product from NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. And the key thing what you find here is that whenever you have high polluted cases, these clouds are more high in the atmosphere. They have more top of atmosphere cooling, also more cooling at the surface. That's the key thing from these three plots, which shows you short wave radiation, then long wave radiation, and then net radiation. And if you compare individual plots between MODIS, and MERA, they all really mimic each other. Two very different data set, and about satellite is about 15 years of data set, MERA is about a decade data set, but they mimic. And that's what clearly shows that at the surface, these aerosol induced what we call as cloud invigoration. This cloud invigoration effect are making some important structural changes in the cloud, which has not been seen before. And that actually causes a lot more cooling on the surface. And that may actually impede monsoon development in subsequent years. So this is what in the cartoon we actually depicted here, is in a less polluted case, you have less number of supercooled droplets which go in. And because you have lesser droplets and ice crystals getting formed, you have lesser amount of condensational energy that will come out. And you see this anvil, you know, cloud, CB cloud generally has this terrace kind of structure, which is called anvil, the shorter anvil. But if you look into this polluted clouds, a lot more particles will cross this, what we call is the condensational regime. And then they form these super cool droplets. A lot more energy will come out. It will fuel the cloud development and it will go further up. As it goes up, it gets frozen. And as it freezes, more energy will come out. And you have a lot bigger anvil that comes out and might in fact separates out and can form a separate cloud here. So that what we showed here, and that's the way, in fact, a very, very highly polluted region, which is there in the central India, mainly overlapping with ICMR, can have important effects on cloud, the surface and top of atmosphere energy balance. And they can also change. What you see in the bottom, you have a cartoon. On the left, you have the standard temperature lapse rate. But due to this changes, you have slightly inversion kind of condition, which can inhibit convection and therefore can inhibit monsoon formation. That is what we showed in this work. Now, another interesting follow-up work was that we wanted to see that we had a network of automatic weather stations at Kanpur. What you see here, that Kanpur map, if you can see on the third panel, and we had three stations and very interesting set of data we saw, that the black is basically upwind during monsoon time and the red is urban location and the green blue is basically downwind, a very rural kind of location. And over 3-4 years of data, very well calibrated rainfall data, we found that all the time, urban location receives more rainfall, right? Followed by the downwind rural and followed by, which is this, finally the upwind GNB location, right? And not only that, in frequency distribution, if you try to plot as a function of time, again, we saw bimodal distribution was appearing at the urban location. Then we tested that with TRMM data set. And that also showed very similar thing. You see this map shows Kanpur. And as you move from this upwind, somewhere here is the GNV side, here is IITK, here is the DVS and then ITK. And you see towards center and downwind, you have more rainfall. And this is a 15 years of TRMM data. So what we did that, we did two experiments. We chose two sets of cities here. If you see in these maps, one city is right at the foothills of Himalayas, which are more polluted. For example, Delhi, Agra, Kanpur, Durgapur, and Kolkata. And then another at the flank of these Ganga plains, southern flank of Ganga plains, and which are, for example, Ahmedabad, Indore, Nagpur, Vadodara, etc., which are certainly less polluted. And then a modeling experiment was done carefully. And what we plot here on the x-axis is a cloud condensation nuclei in percentile bins. Cloud condensation nuclei are very important proxy for aerosols, right? So these are particles on which cloud droplet forms. And this plot, you see, has been shown for these five polluted cities. And on the y-axis, you have enhancement in rain in the downwind of the city. And exactly same way this is plotted here, on the cities which are less polluted at the southern flank of Ganga plains, right? And what you see, a very clear trend emerges for these polluted cities. So as you go, you know, to more and more aerosols, higher CCN, there are probably 2-5% more rainfall happens at the downwind of the city, right? Depending on how the wind is moving. If you look at the center of the city, that is enhancement rate in rain in urban area, you do not see such a very, you know, clear signal. And that's true here as well. So you see two sets of conclusion. One is that the polluted cities, that aerosols are redistributing the rain spatially, and they are causing more rain in the downwind of the city. And this is more in the case of polluted than in the clean cities, relatively cleaner cities. And then we did just to understand, create a mechanistic understanding of this, we did a modeling experiment. In the model, two kind of experiments were done. One was basically a control, which was exactly the way the Kanpur, this was done over Kanpur, by the way. and another where urban center was totally removed from Kanpur. And rather going into the details of this, I can just show you that there are two or three plots here which show that there are some interesting perturbation happened between and including urban and excluding urban region in the model, that it seems like urban heat island causes a clear, you know, a cyclonic weather over urban area, and it changes the entire near surface energy balance in a drastic way, which drives the convection within the boundary layer, and therefore it further, you know, kind of lifts and, you know, does further for cloud formation, etc., etc. So this is one, you can say, the interesting follow-up on the work related to cloud and aerosol and how it connects with rainfall, and probably to certain extent with the land use and land cover changes. This is an ongoing work where as a part of one, you know, this INCOMPASS, which was a multi-institutional Indo-UK experiment conducted in 2014 to 2017, mainly to understand that, again, land use processes and how they can be better parameterized and implemented in large scale weather forecasting models. That was the main aim. And in that, actually, Kanpur was a super site. So what we are showing, we had flux tower. We still have it, but it's not fully functional as of now, unfortunately. So we have a flux tower, which is shown in the top left figure, and which measures everything from which you can get complete energy, you know, closure near surface. And this, the longest panel, what we show here is basically you have a black lines, which shows aerosol optical depth, and red lines are temperature. And then we also show here is the water vapor, you know, water vapor content, that how much is there in the atmosphere, that they can measure. They have a sensor, they can directly measure how much is the water there. And we actually identified three interesting episodes. One is a high aerosol variability and low variability in temperature and water vapor. One is a high variability in both these things. One is finally a low variability in aerosol and high variability in temperature and water vapor content, right? These three episodes will look a little in a little more detailed way. So rather than going into too much of detail of this, what I can just show you that these top two, so there are basically three columns you see for these three cases. And these rows are basically one for aerosol parameters. Second is measured radiation parameters. And the bottom two panels in blue bars, one is basically what we call as the direct aerosol related radiative forcing. So these are calculated. And the bottom most is the diffuse radiation that is also calculated. And what you see that between these three episodes, there are striking changes in the direct effect of aerosols and the diffuse radiation that also may have been caused because of aerosols. And then we look that into further at, as I will show you in the next thing, next plot, that these direct effects directly impact the sensible heat budget near the surface where the plants are, whereas these diffuse radiation changes the way plant photosynthesize, right? So these two change the plant or impact the plants in two different ways, but combined, eventually they change the evaporative fraction, and that may cause or may change the way plants grow, right? So this is what is shown here, and that's very nicely comes out, that in the low aerosol regime, you see that as the vapor pressure deficit happens, because of this stomatal responses, you have huge resistance posed by the plant's canopy, okay? Just in order to simply shut down any further loss of water. But in the blue line, a different kind of response you are seeing here. The aerosols try to offset that, And even when you have large deficit of water, vapor pressure deficit means you have larger deficit of water, still it tries to minimize the stomatal response, and therefore you do not have so much of canopy resistance that is posed by this phenomena. So that is what is just currently being submitted to ERL. This is a direct kind of evaluation which Burney and Ramanathan came out. It's one of the probably the most you can say authoritative work related to the impact of this short-lived climate pollutant, what they call it, over two different kind of crops over India. So they choose basically all different major states which grow either wheat or rice. And that you see also overlap with the largest amount of pollution. So the color code already I have discussed before, that as you go from the light color to dark, it shows more optical depth, and it shows basically you have larger pollution. Okay, so they looked into that state-wise very carefully, and detailed statistical analysis were done in this PNAS paper. And I am not showing the details of that, but what they came out from this was two very, very interesting conclusions. So on the top, what you see state-wise, you see what's the loss of wheat yield, right, in percentage terms, because of pollution that is yellow, and because of climate that is greenhouse gas, or warming effect is in blue. And what you see in the case of wheat, it is the pollution, or what they call it, mostly they looked at aerosols and ozone, and they found that this effect is far more winning than the effect coming from the warming, right? And that is causing as much as on an average, maybe about 25% loss in overall wheat, yield of wheat in entire India. And if you look at the rice, by and large picture remains similar, except that for few states, what you also see, because of warming, you have a little excess yield of rice is happening. And also the overall loss in the rice production is not as much as it was in the case of wheat. So what you see, that a very clear picture is emerging that there are variety of pathways through which aerosols can impact either plant growth or plant or the yield from these different kind of plants. And one can achieve a lot if we try to mitigate. In terms of this, you can see that it directly goes into the direction of food security of the country. This is another work which was done by the people from ISRO. We were also part of that because it was a large network of ozone monitors which was set up under ISRO Geosphere Biosphere program. And they took two indices and tried to compute again the loss in wheat and rice only because of ozone. Okay, so ozone was the only pollutant which was considered here. And they looked into basically four regions of the country, north, east, west, and south. And what you see that similar numbers, this study also arrived at what I already show in the work of Barney and Ramanathan. A related work now, a more recent work, what has been just done in a collaborative way, where we tried to understand that, you know, that there has been a change in law in Punjab where they shifted the sowing time, paddy sowing time from early June or third or second week of June to end of June or early July. And that, you know, had shifted the entire cultivation of paddy, and therefore the crop residue burning has started happening, which coincides with the poor weather over northern part of the country, and which really leads to very poor air quality. We all know that, we call it now stubble burning, crop residue burning, etc. So here basically three scenarios were considered using model. One scenario was the original scenario when the law was not amended. Another scenario is the existing scenario. And the third is that if it were further postponed by, let's say, 2 or 3 weeks. And the results were very interesting in a way that what we found that basically in the current scenario, the overall amount of PM2.5 and therefore deterioration in the air quality of Delhi and other states, adjacent states, Haryana and up to Bihar, is more dependent on the amount and the type of crop residue that is burnt rather than the timing. However, if the sowing time will further be extended by, let's say, 2 weeks, so now it is happening up to, let's say, 5th or 10th July, but if it goes beyond 15th or 25th July, then what we will see is a further deterioration of the air quality over Delhi and other region. In other words, that you'll have 30-35% more PM2.5 that will be seen in the atmosphere of these 3-4 states if we further extend the sowing time. So this is like something which is has to be kept in mind. And again, this relates to when we discuss about sustainable agriculture. So there are very many ways which people are talking about that, but there are things which are, you can say that, which are short fixes, but maybe a more semi-permanent or permanent kind of fixers will be that whether the farmers are incentivized and maybe they have a choice for crop shifting, etc., crop switching rather, that probably would alleviate us from this problem in a longer term or something like that. Now, I think one or two more related things I will show. So, Bimal, can you tell me how much time I have still?
I think you can take probably 10 minutes.
Okay. I think I'll be done well within 10 minutes, hopefully. Yeah. So this is now another very, very interesting work which came from Lyle Wild's group, where he did a fantastic simulations using model. And then he projected that what is the overall mortality because of outdoor air pollution in 2010. And you see that it comes the way in the left, what you see is overall mortality per square kilometer, per 100 square kilometer. And you see that Gangetic Plain and some part of India comes out very, very prominently, and some part of China as well. And on the right side, they linked it with some specific sources. And what you see that entire India is basically blue, which is a residential combustion. So whether that is true or not, because this end of the day, it was very much a modeling study. But the fact is that residential dirty energy sources does cause irreparable loss to human organs, etc., and can lead to premature death. So that's kind of, you can see that where we are in terms of impact of air pollution on human health. This is a study we just did last winter in Delhi, where we tried to estimate the what is called as ROS. So this ROS are kind of some kind of assays. And these assays are directly related to how these particulate matter will damage your lungs. So if high amount of ROS are there in particulate matter, that means these particles are more oxidative in nature, and therefore they will damage your cells very quickly. And we found that, and this was done in a nicer way. So this was done in a real-time fashion. So therefore, you can really link ROS with the sources of the pollution, right? So that was a good thing about that. And what we found that it was way higher than what some of the authors have found in some cities of US, probably 5 to 8 times higher. So these are again giving us a little bit more, you can say, regions for which we should try to start thinking of, immediate either switching to cleaner sources or mitigating these harmful pollutants from the atmosphere. This is a earlier work what we did related to, again, harmful, you can say, not a nice effect of particulate matter. Most of you know Taj Mahal. Some of you might have seen that when you visit this iconic monument, you have might have seen that a very elaborate cleaning process is there, which lasts from 1 to 3 years, because you see that's a huge monument. So we wanted to understand, because for long there has not been a clear understanding that what causes discoloration of outer surfaces of Taj Mahal. And what we did, that we did some sampling inside for almost a year. We collected particle chemical composition and particle size distribution. And then we also put some surrogate marble surfaces inside Taj Mahal surrounding. And by doing the modeling of these deposited murky material on the surface, we could work out what would be the change in the color, how our eye will perceive the change in the color of the marble surfaces. And we related it with that changes which happened in the surrogate marble surfaces. And from that, we could clearly come out that particulate matter is clearly causing that discoloration of Taj Mahal. And 50% of that is because of carbonaceous matter, and 50% of that is because of dust particles. And that led to some corrective measures taken by various government agencies and on the ground. A follow-up study of that was to connect it, this discoloration, to some important low-hanging fruits, you can call, like sources which can easily be plugged or mitigated. So we found that, for example, dung cake burning or trash burning, these, if that can be stopped, we can cut down good amount of these deposited, you know, particulate matter on the Taj Mahal surfaces. So again, it brings to the point of sustainable development, where you see that air pollution has a direct linkages with how we deal with the municipal solid waste disposal. So if we correctly dispose it, if we don't burn it in a spurious way everywhere, definitely we can cut down its emission and therefore its adverse effect, the emitted, you know, pollutants that can cause to various entities and human beings. Okay. This is an ongoing work from Delhi, where it's the first time we have tried to do a real-time, you know, estimations of different kind of metals. So there are about, you can measure about 40 metals in real time. So this is a very unique application of these real-time metal monitoring, that if you actually, you know, monitor PM2.5 and PM10. So these are two different sizes. You know, PM10 is the particles in size less than 10 micron, and 2.5 is less than 2.5. So they actually kind of designate two different set of sources. PM10 is more from natural mechanical processes. PM2.5 is more from anthropogenic. So if you plot their ratio on the x-axis and you plot their enrichment factor. So enrichment factor is defined here. That is basically with respect to some non-reactive element. If you take ratio of the ratios, it can give you a good idea that whether a particular elemental concentration you see in the ambient, is it because only from crustal elements, from natural processes, or it has been impacted from the anthropogenic processes as well. So by doing this, we can see across three cities, right? Interestingly, so this paper is almost, I think, through in Delhi, Beijing, and Krakow in Poland. All these can be grouped into five major class of, you know, sources. You see that there are crustal, there are traffic, solid fuel, from traffic and industry and combustion. So this gives a lot more handle to the policymakers in terms of how do they go about mitigating these things, right? I will skip now these because I want to now conclude in 3 or 4 minutes. This is what is a very interesting work done by Professor Drew Schindel of Duke University, where he tried to look into what kind of co-benefits one can achieve by, let's say, targeting just one source. So what he did in this paper, he only tried to plug a traffic source. And what you show here is the change what you get. The benefit what you get is in yellow. So I'm showing it in the oval here, circle. So what you see is that premature mortality, for example, for India, if you don't cut down that source, it's about that time was 40 to 60,000 from that source only. And you can brought it to minus 20, right? So you gain that. Likewise, he showed it for different kind of crop. And finally, he monetized it. So you see that in this orange's big bar, I have shown it just to highlight for India. You see that if you cut down only one source, you can gain of the order of few hundreds of billion dollars. I remember that if we cut down many sources, what we can gain, right? So currently several efforts are going on basically to scale up the monitoring in the country. One thing what we are leading here at IIT Kanpur to bring different institutions, it's a multi-institutional large project where we have tried to develop indigenously these sensors, which are connected through different kind of network technologies, where many of the calibration and analytics are done on the server. So what you see that in the center, it's all said here, machine learning. And then we are planning to basically make this data available through app, internet, etc., to the citizen at large. And these kind of network currently already at some scale are running in our campus in Delhi. Now we are doing one very rigorous evaluation of this technology using Maharashtra board's reference monitors, so that that boards can also come on board with us and we can take it, you know, further to the field and to the larger scale. And in part of another project, we are also trying to basically fill in some of these states which are shown here as red. So about 100 sensors we are planning to deploy in five states around 18 or 20 villages. So that way I think it will be one of the kind network covering some of the rural regions of India where hitherto there was no monitoring going on, right? This is a work was done during COVID time where the government was very keen to understand how the sources have changed when the COVID-induced lockdown happened. And we have tried this technology, what we call as a real-time source identification. So using a set of instruments which measures chemical composition online. So once you put the instrument there and immediately it gives you what are there in particulate matter. One example I just showed in terms of metal monitoring. And using that, we can give it to Central Pollution Control Board that how sources changed. And that was very intuitive. And in fact, it was well substantiated by secondary independent data. So it found its way in the report which CPCB released about a month or half ago, you know, basically giving the outlook of the air quality, pan-India air quality during lockdown. Another effort which we are leading here at IIT Kanpur to create a network of institutions, which is called as National Knowledge Network, which is basically it has been designated formally as an advisory group to Central Pollution Control Board. And this has been entrusted with identifying and nurturing and graduating other institutions, which are called as institutes of repute. The idea is that to create local capacity building, because remember that in the first phase of National Clean Air Mission, there are 122 non-attainment cities which are not meeting government standard. So the idea is that every city, one should have a local technical partner, which should be able to help them achieve all the goals under National Clean Air Mission. So that is going on. We already have identified about 115 institutions and about half of them have shown their willingness to work with this network. So this is what currently you see that the circles are non-attainment cities, which are spread across the country, barring maybe Kerala or one or two other states. And as of now, we have also these STARS, which are institutes of repute, are also spread across the country. Another such effort we are currently leading at IIT Kanpur in a public private partnership, where a leading think tank based in Bangalore has been supported by a large philanthropic organizations to help them develop emission inventories. So remember that in one of my aerosol related cartoon, I showed that emission is very important in order to better predict using your models about the PM concentration or various pollutant concentrations. So we did not have a uniform emission inventory which covers across the entire country for different seasons, etc. So this is a large effort where C-STEP has joined hands with the National Knowledge Network and is supported by this large philanthropy. So these are some of the efforts which are going on currently to help National Clean Air Program. So I will stop here. Thank you all for listening to me, and I'll be happy to answer some questions if you might have.